Hello students, we will continue with chapter 4 of business studies of class 11. In this session, we will discuss a new type of banking, that is e-banking. The growth of internet and e-commerce is dramatically changing everyday life. With the world wide web and e-commerce transforming the world into a digital global village, the latest wave in information technology is internet banking. It is part of virtual banking and another delivery channel for customers. Internet banking means any user with a PC and a browser can be connected to the bank's website to perform any of the virtual banking functions and avail any of the bank's services. The bank has a centralized database that is web enabled. All the services that the bank has permitted on the internet are displayed on the menu. Any service can be selected and further interactions is dictated by the nature of service. These types of services provided by the banks on the internet are called e-banking. It lowers the transaction cost, adds value to the bank relationships and empowers customers. E-banking is electronic banking or banking using electronic media. Thus, e-banking is a service provided by many banks that allows a customer to conduct banking transactions such as managing savings, checking accounts, applying for loans or paying bills over the internet using a personal computer, mobile telephone or handset computer. The range of services offered by e-banking are electronic funds transfer EFT, automated teller machine ATM and point of sales POS, electronic data interchange EDI and credit cards, electronic or digital cash. Benefits of e-banking. There are various benefits of e-banking provided to the customers, which are: e-banking provides 24 hours, 365 days a year services to the customers of the bank. Next, customers can make some of the permitted transactions from office or house or while traveling via mobile telephone. Next, it inculcates a sense of financial discipline by recording each and every transaction. Another benefit, greater customer satisfaction by offering unlimited access to the bank, not limited by walls of the bank, or less riskier and greater security to the customer as they can avoid traveling with cash. What are the benefits of e-banking to the banks? They are, first of all, e-banking provides competitive advantage to the banks. Next, e-banking provides unlimited network to the banks and not limited to the number of branches. The other benefit is load on branches can be considerably reduced by establishing centralized database and by taking over functions. We have discussed in detail the business service of banks provided to the economy. In detail, we have discussed the various functions of banks, the benefits of banking services to the business as well as society, the benefits of e-banking. Now we come to the next important service provided to the society and business, which is insurance. Friends, life is full of uncertainties. The chances of occurrence of an event causing losses are quite uncertain. There are risks of death and disability for human life, fire, burglary risk for property, perils of the sea for shipment of goods, and so on. If any of these takes place, the individuals or organizations may suffer a great loss, sometimes beyond their capacities to bear the same. It is to minimize the impact of such uncertainties that there is a need for insurance. Insurance is thus a device by which the loss likely to be caused by an uncertain event is spread over a number of persons who are exposed to it and who prepare to insure themselves against such an event. It is a contract or agreement under which one party agrees in return for a consideration to pay an agreed amount of money to the other party to make good a loss, damage or injury to something of value in which the insured has pecuniary interest as a result of which some uncertain event. The agreement or contract is put in writing and is known as policy. The person whose risk is covered is called insured, and the firm which insures the risk of loss is known as insurer. Fundamental principles of insurance. The basic principle of insurance is that an individual or a business concern chooses to spend a definitely known sum in place of huge amount of loss in an indefinite future loss. Thus, insurance is the substitution of a small periodic payment, that is premium. The risk of loss still remains, but the loss is spread over a large number of policyholders exposed to the same risk. The premium paid by them are pooled, out of which the loss sustained by any policyholder is compensated. Thus, risks are shared with others. From the analysis of past events, the insurer, that is an insurance company or an underwriter, knows the probable losses caused by each type of risk covered by insurance. Now we come to the functions of insurance, which are providing certainty. Insurance provides on payment for the risk of loss. There are uncertainties of happenings of time and amount of loss. Insurance removes these uncertainties and the assured receives payment of loss. The insurer charges premium for providing certainty. Next benefit is protection. The second main function of insurance is to provide protection from probable chances of loss. Insurance cannot stop the happening of a risk or event, but it can compensate for losses arising out of it. The other advantage is risk sharing. On the happening of a risk event, the loss is shared by all the persons exposed to it. The share is obtained from every insured member by way of premiums. Another advantage is assist in capital formation. The accumulated funds of the insurer received by way of premium payments made by the insured are invested in various income generating schemes. Principles of insurance. The principles of insurance are the rules of action or conduct adopted by the stakeholders involved in the insurance business. They are utmost good faith. A contract of insurance is a contract of abrime fide, that is, a contract found on utmost good faith. Both the insurer and the insured should display good faith towards each other in regard to the contract. It is the duty of the insured to voluntarily make full, accurate disclosure of all facts material to the risk being proposed, and the insurer to clear all the terms and conditions in the insurance contract. Failure to make disclosure of material facts by the insurance makes the contract of insurance voidable at the discretion of the insurer. Insurable interest. The insured must have an insurable interest in the subject matter of insurance. Insurable interest means some pecuniary interest in the subject matter of the insurance contract. The insured must have an interest in the preservation of the thing or life insured so that he or she will suffer financially on the happening of the event against which he or she is insured. In case of insurance of property, insurable interest of the insured in the subject matter of the insurance must exist at the time of happening of the event. Next principle is indemnity. All the insurance contracts of fire or marine insurance are contracts of indemnity. According to it, the insurer undertakes to put the insured in the event of loss in the same position that he occupied immediately before the happening of the event insured against. In other words, the insurer undertakes to compensate the insured for the loss caused to him or her due to the damage or destruction of property insured. The compensation payable and the loss suffered are to be measured in terms of money. The principle of indemnity is not applicable to life insurance. The next principle is proximate cause. According to this principle, an insurance policy is designed to provide compensation only for such losses as are caused by the perils which are stated in the policy. When the loss is the result of two or more causes, the proximate cause means the direct and the most dominant and most effective cause of which the loss is the natural consequence. Next important principle of insurance is subrogation. It refers to the right of the settlement of a claim. As far as the right of insured in respect of recovery from an alternative source is involved. After the insured is compensated for the loss or the damage to the property insured by him or her, the right of the property of ownership of such property passes on to the insurer, that is the insurance company. This is because the insured should not be allowed to make any profit by selling the damaged property or in the case of lost property being recovered. Next principle of insurance is contribution. As per this principle, it is the right of an insurer who has paid claim under an insurance to call upon other liable insurers to contribute for the loss of payment. It implies that in case of double insurance, the insurers are to share the losses in proportion to the amount assured by each of them. In case there is a loss, when there is more than one policy on the same property, the insured will have no right to recover more than the full amount of his actual loss. If the full amount is recovered from one insurer, the right to obtain further payment from other insurer will cease. Next principle is mitigation. This principle states that it is the duty of the insured to take reasonable steps to minimize the loss or damage. Suppose goods are kept in a storehouse which catches fire. Then the owner of the goods should try to recover the goods and save them from fire to minimize the loss or damage. The insured must behave with great prudence and not be careless just because there is an insurance cover. If reasonable care is not taken, like any prudent person, then the claim from the insurance company may be lost. Now let us test our understanding of the concept of insurance. First question, in case of life insurance, insurable interest must exist at the time of taking the policy, death, C, A and B, or D, neither A nor B? The answer is A. Second question, which of the following is not a contract of indemnity? A, life insurance, B, fire insurance, C, marine insurance, or D, all of the above? The answer is of course A. So in this session, we have discussed the meaning and benefits of e-banking in today's scenario. Thereafter, we studied reasons for insurance in business, its advantages. Then we discussed in detail the various principles of insurance, the different terms and conditions for insured and insurance company. Now, in the next session, we will study about the important business services necessary for survival of business in today's complicated business world. Thank you.